Welcome back to the Make or Break Shop. This week we're gonna be getting into 3D printing and we're gonna see if this $200 printer is worth it. So I got sent this Alfawise U30 3D printer from Gearbest, and we're gonna run it through its paces. This is my very first time doing anything with 3D printing, so take all of that with a grain of salt. But I'm coming at this as a complete beginner. So we're gonna come at this like someone who's never used one before, hopefully to give you guys some ideas if this could be a good option for you, especially on the lower end. This is around 200 bucks. So there's gonna be some different topics that we hit for this review video. If you want to jump to those specific ones, you can check those out in the links in the description. But to start out, we're going to do an unboxing and assembly. All right. So a little while ago, I was sent a CNC from Gearbest. It's their like Gearbest brand called Alfawise. I did a review on that. And a lot of you guys had a lot of comments about how this could be a potential use for the shop. Because CNCs are really, really cool. I've actually got an X carve, which is right down there, that I enjoy using. But I got sent something brand new that I wanted to try out this week. So this is the U30 Pro Alfawise, and it comes together mostly assembled. So unlike the CNC, I had to pretty much put everything together. This guy should be fairly easy. So we're gonna go through everything we've got really quick, and then we're going to dive into the build, and then we're gonna get to printing. All right, so the first thing is we've got a build plate. I will include the actual build dimensions right there, but this is about 9 1/4 by 9 1/4 square. They got a little bit of filament that they sent with it. Then we've got the LCD, I think touchpad, power, zip ties, cabling. This is gonna be, I guess, one of the gantries. Lots of tools, some aluminum extrusion. Honestly, don't know what this is. Oh, this is what you put the filament on, I guess on top. So this is like a spool. So what's cool is for the most part, the thing is assembled. So some more extrusion, rod for the Z-axis, so a threaded rod. All right, so you've got the power supply, and then it looks like the Y-axis is just built directly on. For the most part, everything is already wired up. Another little gantry, lots of nuts and bolts, as well as all of the tooling. And then this is the Z-axis motor. Cool. And then one more of these aluminum extrusions. So I'm gonna do my best to put this together just with the quick start guide that actually came with it. There are a couple videos online of people assembling these, but I'm gonna try to just go straight off their instructions. So let's start on the assembly. Looks like we're gonna start out with this guy. First thing is these guys attach underneath. So now we are attaching the belt. So we're doing something like this, where it's looped back and then zip tied onto the top. So now we are attaching this onto the assembly. Assembling the lead screw for the Z-axis, tightening in those set screws. So now we're gonna be attaching the top. So now we're installing the limit switch, which needs to be in about 1/2 inch.
Close.
All right, so this is the build plate. Take off these alligator clips. Then we add in these springs, these gears, and I'm guessing this is how you can level out your bed, because the more you screw it in, the more it comes down. Back on top. And this is a glass build plate. I know some are flexible, but this one is glass. And next up, we've got the touch screen. So that overall is the assembly. Actually doesn't take super long. Now, the only thing that is left is all of these need to be hooked up, and they all are labeled. So I just realized that this is assembled backwards. This needs to be flipped the other way. Then the nozzle is actually in the front, and then the Z-axis is on the back. So we're going to do that really, really fast. All right, so it's flipped around. You can see the hot end is actually in the front now. So we're going to connect all the cables up. They are labeled. And then I was actually trying to find the Y to make sure it was plugged in. But the cables are already put in from the assembly. And then the last thing I have are these E switches. And this one, I did not know what it was because I've never 3D printed, but this I would imagine is what brings the filament into the hothead. And last but not least, we've got an LCD. All right, so let's get this thing powered up. Gonna flip the switch on the back. Fan is pretty loud. All right, so let's see if this thing actually works. We're gonna jog to the left. We're gonna see if the Y works. Yep, and then the Z. So now that we've got this thing up and running, the paper manual is pretty much done for the installation. There's actually a full PDF that has a little bit better instructions on assembly on a USB stick. What we're going to do now is actually level the machine, and it's got some automatic leveling in terms of they'll move the gantry around. Then they're suggesting the method of using a sheet of paper to make sure it just barely catches on all four corners. So the leveling is working out pretty well so far. Looks like I'm just going to hit all of the buttons. Right now, it is going down. And you can see that this was way too far down to start out. And now I'm gonna sheet of paper. And then we wanna get it to where it just barely catches. Right there. All right, so I think we're leveled. So it actually comes with some filament, and I'm going to load it on the back side. So I'm guessing I just hit load, and we'll see what happens. It's gonna be going in right here. To load it, I gotta wait for this thing actually to heat up, and we're actually gonna time it. So 2 minutes. So we're gonna load in the filament. All right, so we've got this thing pretty much set up. We're gonna load in one of the models that just came with the printer. We're gonna print out the Benchy, which is a good one that I see lots of people do. Files, this guy, and hopefully this is gonna work. I actually used the PLA filament that came with the printer. Because of that, I actually didn't print. There's a little smokestack that comes up right there. Didn't print that because I ran out of filament. But one good feature about this is it has a runout sensor. So I didn't have more filament I could actually put in, but it did let me know, hey, you ran out of filament. Do you want to replace it and keep going? So that's super handy. But overall, the print quality has gone pretty well. I'm still kind of dialing in all of the settings, but you can see for the most part that the layer lines did really well. This was the file directly off of the SD card. And then one of the big things that I'm wanting to do with 3D printing is getting into making some props. So I've got this TIE fighter helmet that I actually 3D modeled that we're doing the big version of right now. But you guys can see that for the most part, this is actually a really good print. This was at 0.1 or 100 microns, and for the layer height, pretty good detail. And then the bottom is just because those are the supports and I need to get those off. All right, so let's talk about some of the pros on the actual assembly piece of this thing. Overall, it's pretty nice for what you get. It's a metal construction. You've got aluminum extrusion for all of the sides. The screen is a color touchscreen, which is actually pretty nice for this price point. A lot of the times you just have just a really simple display with a dial that you go through all the settings. But it comes with a glass build plate that has been doing pretty well on the adhesion side of things. It's been working great for me. And then you can see that the gantry is actually attached with wheels in a V shape, which has kept this thing pretty locked in and pretty tight. It's got a 24 volt power supply, and that really comes into factor when you're trying to heat up the hot end, so the nozzle where all the filament is gonna come out. It came with everything. I've seen a few other reviews where some things have been damaged or bent, but in my case, this guy came out of the box great. All the limit switches worked, nothing was bent, and the assembly overall was pretty easy to put together. So a couple features with this that is nice to have. Like I said, we already mentioned the runout sensor. It also has a loss of power feature, which in my shop, I trip a lot of breakers with my bigger machines. And so if I do lose power, I can flip it back on and it's gonna start printing again. That is something I do not have on my bigger machines, like my Venables X-Carve for that one. If I lose power to my CNC, I gotta restart the entire thing, which is a bummer, as well as my 50 watt laser. The same thing is gonna happen. So from the build quality, there really isn't much negative. It is kind of noisy. It actually isn't. Stepper motors, those are great and they're real quiet, but it's the fan that is built into the actual electronics. So you guys can kind of hear with this microphone. And I am printing out helmets. So this is the bottom portion of a TIE fighter helmet, and this was one of 8 pieces that I'm actually gonna have to make. And this thing took about 16 hours, so a real long print. The thickness on this was 200 microns, so you can kind of see that. And again, you can still kind of see some of the spots where I have less the support marks and everything, but overall still a really nice print. And in an upcoming video, I'm gonna be making a real cool TIE fighter mask as a prop. And this is a really good test with this. That is one of the things that's kind of a drawback, is that for small stuff, it's great. The print bed is plenty big enough. Print bed is actually 220 by 220 millimeters by 250 on the Z axis. Pretty good size. This is about as big as something that I could get on the mask side of things. There's some bigger machines. Actually, Alfawise makes one, it's the U20, which I really am interested in checking out because I think I might be able to print an entire helmet all in one go. And that's kind of comparable to the Creality, the CR10, which is really, really popular. So a good comparison for this size of a unit is the Creality Ender 3, still around that $200 price point. So probably the biggest drawback with this guy that a lot of other printers do really well is their software is actually open source. So this software is proprietary to Gearbest, to Alfawise. And so from what I've heard, they're actually really good. If you guys got complaints, they'll publish a firmware release. So as I was actually recording that in the background, I noticed I actually had my very first failed print. So this is what was on the build plate. And something happened to where the actual gantry shifted over a good, probably half an inch. You can see, especially like right there. But I bring that up because that is one feature this doesn't have, which other printers do that are more expensive, and that is collision detection. So if this thing's gonna run into something, it's just gonna keep going. And in the cases where I can't actually move it out of the way, which is bad in itself, it's gonna move the entire gantry, and then you're gonna get that shifting that happened like that. All right, so ever since I had that print failure, I have been trying to figure out what is going on. I actually have run through a lot of different solutions that I'm gonna show you here real quick. So one thing that I wanted to correct is I said the firmware was actually not open source, and that actually wasn't correct. I reached out to Gearbest because I was just trying to install an update to the firmware. I saw a bunch of people have done that, and I thought you just used the SD card and you would upload it and wasn't working. But they responded back, that was actually for the U30, not the U30 Pro. The U30 Pro actually is open source. You can check it out. So you can see that the motherboard firmware is actually Marlin 1.1.9. And so that is open source. You can actually download everything from GitHub, and you can actually even reflash the entire motherboard using the Arduino toolkit. You can download everything and pull this in, and then you can recompile everything. You can see I actually have it set up right here, all the conditionals and everything. So that is something you can do. So I started to go down that route, and then actually started to play around with the slicing software. So if you're brand new to 3D printing like I was, this is gonna be new for you too. So basically this is how you create all of the G code, or all the commands that the 3D printer uses to move around and extrude out the filament. You're gonna bring in a 3D model, and I've got one right here. This is actually part of the helmet that I'm printing right now. It is flipped upside down. I've already sliced it, and so you can see all the different layers as it builds up. So Cura is free to download. It is the slicing software that Ultimaker uses, but a lot of people use it even if you don't have an Ultimaker 3D printer. This is a whole nother series of videos that we can dive into the settings. But basically, I've been playing around, and a couple of the settings that I switched that if you guys run into this issue, this could help is really with this travel. And so this avoid printed parts when traveling and the Z-hop when retracted. And so that basically means that for whatever reason, I feel like that hot end was hitting against the model and then it was shifting everything over and then it would keep on printing. And since I've done this, this has been working pretty well. Also, it was super hot in the garage and I kind of wonder if the PLA was starting to peel up just a little bit. And so I've brought it inside and the prints have gone well. This will add a lot of time to your actual printing time. You can see this one's gonna take 8 hours and an hour of that is actually the retractions, which takes quite a bit of time. But all of this stuff you can really dive into. There's a lot of cool settings and things you can figure out with that. And actually what I'm gonna do is include this profile for you guys in the link down below if you do pick up one of these machines. This is just what's working for me. Again, I'm super new to all this and so I'm probably gonna be tweaking this stuff as I go. But to do these large prints, they have been seeming to work fairly well. All right, let's jump back into the shop. So if you're anything like me, if you're learning something brand new, you can get pretty obsessed. And actually last week I spent a good 3.5 days straight, full work days creating this 3D model, which this again part is just an eighth of. And I make that available to the awesome supporters over on Patreon, anything that I'm building, whether that is a miter station plans or that is a 3D model of a super geeky thing from Star Wars. So if you're interested in supporting this channel, that is a great way to do it again over at patreon.com/makeorbreakshop. There's links down below. There are a bunch of different levels from the basic to the levels where you can actually get access to all of the things that I model in 3D, whether that is in Fusion 360 or that is inside of Blender. There's going to be a lot more things like this coming here very soon as I get more into prop making, as well as full plans on the woodworking side of things, whether it is cabinets or tables or shop furniture. So I encourage you guys to check that out. But again, overall for this price point, I really think this is a really good option if you guys are interested in getting into 3D printing. I've got links down below. They are affiliate links, and so you guys do help out this channel at no cost to you, except for the cost of the printer. But those should be the best deals that you can find if you're interested in checking these things out. I've also included links to a couple of the other printers we talked about here, like the Creality CR10 and the Ender 3, as good beginner options if you're interested in getting into 3D printing. So I would love to know from you guys, first off, do you 3D print? Is this something you guys have in your shop? And if you are into more of kind of a traditional woodworking shop, which I know a lot of you guys are, can you actually see using this inside of your shop? Because I'm going to be especially using this to make tool holders for a big tool wall that I'm going to have here coming up very soon. We've got a bunch of other projects in this shop, whether it is geeky and DIY like this or big shop projects like miter stations and all different types of stuff. So you can check it out right there. And until next time, go make or break something in your shop. See you guys.